These were the mental antecedents of the externally quiet but internally disturbed youth who in 1656, he had been born in 1632, was summoned before the elders of the synagogue on the charge of heresy. Was it true, they asked him, that he had said to his friends that God might have a body, the world of matter, that angels might be hallucinations, that the soul might be merely life, and that the Old Testament said nothing of immortality? We do not know what he answered. We only know that he was offered an annuity of $500 if he would consent to maintain at least an external loyalty to his synagogue and his faith, that he refused the offer, and that on July 27, 1656, he was excommunicated with all the somber formalities of Hebrew ritual. During the reading of the curse, the wailing and protracted note of a great horn was heard to fall in from time to time. The lights, seen brightly burning at the beginning of the ceremony, were extinguished one by one as it proceeded, till at the end the last went out, typical of the extinction of the spiritual life of the excommunicated man, and the congregation was left in total darkness. Von Vleuten has given us the formula used for excommunication. The heads of the ecclesiastical council hereby make known that, already well assured of the evil opinions and doings of Baruch de Espinoza, they have endeavored in sundry ways and by various promises to turn him from his evil courses. But as they have been unable to bring him to any better way of thinking, on the contrary, as they are every day better certified of the horrible heresies entertained and avowed by him, and of the insolence with which these heresies are promulgated and spread abroad, and many persons worthy of credit having borne witness to these in the presence of the said Espinoza, he has been held fully convicted of the same. Review having therefore been made of the whole matter before the chiefs of the ecclesiastical council, it has been resolved, the councillors assenting thereto, to anathematize the said Spinoza, and to cut him off from the people of Israel, and from the present hour to place him in anathema with the following malediction. With the judgment of the angels and the sentence of the saints, we anathematize, execrate, curse, and cast out Baruch de Espinoza, the whole of the sacred community assenting, in presence of the sacred books with the 613 precepts written therein, pronouncing against him the malediction wherewith Elisha cursed the children, and all the maledictions written in the book of the law. Let him be accursed by day and accursed by night. Let him be accursed in his lying down and accursed in his rising up. Accursed in going out and accursed in coming in. May the Lord nevermore pardon or acknowledge him. May the wrath and displeasure of the Lord burn henceforth against this man, load him with all the curses written in the book of the law, and blot out his name from under the sky. May the Lord sever him from evil from all the tribes of Israel, weight him with all the maledictions of the firmament contained in the book of law, and may all ye who are obedient to the Lord your God be saved this day. Hereby then are all admonished, that none hold converse with him by word of mouth, none hold communication with him by writing, that no one do him any service, no one abide under the same roof with him, no one approach within 4 cubits length of him, and no one read any document dictated by him or written by his hand. Let us not be too quick to judge the leaders of the synagogue, for they faced a delicate situation. No doubt they hesitated to subject themselves to the charge that they were as intolerant of heterodoxy as the Inquisition which had exiled them from Spain. But they felt that gratitude to their hosts in Holland demanded the excommunication of a man whose doubts struck at Christian doctrine quite as vitally as at Judaism. Protestantism was not then the liberal and fluent philosophy which it now becomes. The wars of religion had left each group entrenched immovably in its own creed, cherished now all the more because of the blood just shed in its defense. What would the Dutch authorities say to a Jewish community which repaid Christian toleration and protection by turning out in one generation an Acosta and in the next a Spinoza? Furthermore, religious unanimity seemed to the elders their sole means of preserving the little Jewish group in Amsterdam from disintegration, and almost the last means of preserving the unity, and so ensuring the survival of the scattered Jews of the world. If they had their own state, their own civil law, their own establishments of secular force and power to compel internal cohesion and external respect, they might have been more tolerant. But their religion was to them their patriotism as well as their faith. The synagogue was their center of social and political life as well as of ritual and worship. And the Bible, whose veracity Spinoza had impugned, was the portable fatherland of their people. Under these circumstances, they thought heresy was treason and toleration suicide. One feels that they should have bravely run these risks, but it is as hard to judge another justly as it is to get out of one's skin. Perhaps Manasseh ben Israel, spiritual head of the whole Amsterdam community of Jews, could have found some conciliatory formula within which both the synagogue and the philosopher might have found room to live in mutual peace. But the great rabbi was then in London, persuading Cromwell to open England to the Jews. Fate had written that Spinoza should belong to the world. Retirement and death. He took the excommunication with quiet courage, saying, "It compels me to nothing which I should not have done in any case." But this was whistling in the dark. In truth, the young student now found himself bitterly and pitilessly alone. Nothing is so terrible as solitude, and few forms of it so difficult as the isolation of a Jew from all his people. Spinoza had already suffered in the loss of his old faith. To so uproot the contents of one's mind is a major operation and leaves many wounds. Had Spinoza entered another fold, embraced another of the orthodoxies in which men were grouped like kine huddling together for warmth, he might have found in the role of distinguished convert some of the life which he had lost by being utterly outcast from his family and his race. But he joined no other sect and lived his life alone. His father, who had looked forward to his son's preeminence in Hebrew learning, sent him away. His sister tried to cheat him of a small inheritance. He contested the case in court, won it, and then turned over the bequest to the sister. His former friends shunned him. No wonder there is little humor in Spinoza, and no wonder he breaks out with some bitterness occasionally when he thinks of the keepers of the law. Those who wish to seek out the causes of miracles and to understand the things of nature as philosophers, and not to stare at them in astonishment like fools, are soon considered heretical and impious, and proclaimed as such by those whom the mob adore as the interpreters of nature and the gods. For those men know that once ignorance is put aside, that wonderment would be taken away, which is the only means by which their authority is preserved. The culminating experience came shortly after the excommunication. One night, as Spinoza was walking through the streets, a pious ruffian, bent on demonstrating his theology by murder, attacked the young student with drawn dagger. Spinoza, turning quickly, escaped with a slight wound on the neck. Concluding that there are few places in this world where it is safe to be a philosopher, he went to live in a quiet attic room on the Oterdijk Road outside of Amsterdam. It was now, probably, that he changed his name from Baruch to Benedict. His host and hostess were Christians of the Mennonite sect, and could in some measure understand a heretic. They liked his sadly kind face. Those who have suffered much become very... Thank you.